In this video, we continued the discussion on the Spinor representation, and we will try to understand the gamma matrices and the generators of these representations. So by representation, what I mean is that given a group G, you can take a mapping. The mapping will be called the representation, such that it maps to some linear operator over a vector space. So this mapping, you can think of it like attaching to a group element some sort of a matrix element. So now with this understanding, this, suppose we have this matrix. This is a matrix that is associated with this representation of this group, and this matrix acts on this particular vector. So this is a linear operator that is acting on this particular vector. And in the previous video, we saw that this is a SU2 direct product SU2 representation. And further, we saw that there is different kind of representations of the same group. This is SO plus 1,3, that is proper orthochronous Lorentz transformations. For this same group, there are different kind of representations, like we can have the ordinary lambda mu nu x nu. This is x mu. This kind of transformation here, this lambda, this is also a representation of this SO plus 3,1. And this is what we call as half comma half representation. This is because this representation breaks into the direct product of these two SU2 representation, as we saw in the previous video. Now with this, we can see that this representation is not unitary, precisely because these boost parameters that we have here, there is no iota that can take care of the complex conjugation, and these sigma matrices are Hermitian. So basically, if you take this entire matrix as M dagger won't be identity. So the presence of boost part makes these representation non-unitary. One more thing regarding representation, I must say that so if we have two group elements G1 and G2, then representation of G1 composition G2, where this composition lies in the group, must be a map, and it must also satisfy this particular property, that it is representation of G1 times representation of G2, such that this times that I have here, this is on the linear operator space. So this is also a vector space. So there is a multiplication over this. This multiplication is that. And this here that we have, this is the group composition. So this is like matrix multiplication, we can think. Because in general, vector space don't have this multiplication, but the operators, linear operators, they are what we call, they are the algebra. So that's why they are like vector space over a ring. So they will have this multiplication because the ring has a multiplication. So with this properties, we come to this important theorem that says that a faithful finite dimensional representation of a non-compact Lie group cannot be unitary. So let's try to understand this theorem. The first part is that what is a faithful? So finite dimension makes sense, like the representation will have finite matrix, kind of like this. But what does faithful means is that given two different group elements, they map to distinct, if they map to distinct representations, then we say that the representation is faithful. Like suppose you have G1 that is not equal to G2, then R of G1 will not be equal to R of G2. And this will happen for any two elements of the group that we pick up. So then the representation is faithful. So what this theorem says that if we have a non-compact Lie group, we cannot have a, if we have a non-compact Lie group, we cannot have a unitary faithful representation, which is finite dimensional. So what this, and this is what we are seeing here, this is finite dimensional representation of this Lie group, and we are seeing that this is not unitary. Even the Lorentz transformations are also not unitary. Then let's ask whether this group is compact or not. So we can quite get the intuition that actually this group is not compact, because you see, the what does compactness of a group means? So suppose we have a U1 group, that this is the, or the gauge group, which has these, which has numbers like e power I theta. These are the group elements. This theta is a parameter. So g of theta is this, and this theta runs from 0 to 2 pi, such that theta of 0 is equal to theta of 2 pi, and they map to the same element, that is the identity element. So this group has two properties. One of the properties that the it is bounded, it has a lower bound and an upper bound. And second property is that it is closed, in the sense that the 0 and 2 pi, they are identified together. So these two properties is what makes a group compact. But you see, in case of this Lorentz group, the parameter of boost is essentially not closed. You see, it is bounded by the speed of light, velocity cannot exceed that, but the parameter is not closed, in the sense that it doesn't identify a zero velocity with a velocity with the speed of light. They are like two extreme cases. So because of this non-identification, we say that this SO plus 1,3, that is proper orthochronous Lorentz group, this group is a non-compact Lie group. That means to get a unitary representation of this group, we need to at least restrict ourselves to infinite dimensional representation. So we have already seen that fields carry infinite degrees of freedom. So infinite dimensional representation can be said as a hint towards understanding that we must try to go towards a field theoretic viewpoint. So with this, we make a small change. We say that these parameters, this was the vectors, they are now parameterized by this x, which is the coordinate that we have, the space-time coordinates. But until now we have not. But until now, this was never mentioned anywhere. So everything will remain same, except the fact that the vector space is now infinite dimension. So with this understanding, we now try to see what are the generators of this direct product SU2 group. And now this is again easy, because in the previous video, we briefly discussed the Lie group viewpoint. And there we saw that the generators are given by differentiating the group element with respect to the parameters and with this minus iota psi. So this will be equal to the generator T phi. So with this, we start by writing the generators of the boost. So this is a generator of boost. I am differentiating with respect to boost parameters. But there are three boost parameters, and these three parameters can be given an antisymmetric notion. The three boost parameters will be rho 01, rho 02, and rho 03. And similarly, the three rotation parameters will be I have not mentioned it, but they will be like theta 12, theta 23, and theta 13. So this is like rotation about z-axis, this is rotation about x-axis, and this is rotation about y-axis. So with this understanding, we can see that if we differentiate, if we take this, this is the representation. So if we differentiate this representation with respect to the parameter, we will get the generators. So this is the generator of boost, and this is the generator of rotation. More compactly, we can write this entire thing in terms of the gamma matrices. So these are the gamma matrices. This is gamma 0 and this is gamma I. So I varies from 1, 2, 3, such that they satisfy this kind of a relation. So you see, we already discussed the algebras, which are like the commutation relations, but here we get an anti-commutation relation of this gamma matrices, and this is what we call as Clifford algebra. So with this gamma matrices corresponding to this particular representation that we have seen, we can write the representation, the generator of this representation as this particular form in a more compact way. So these were the generators, the six generators, and we have written it in a compact form here. So from this to this equality, it is easy to understand. We just have to make use of this property, that is gamma mu gamma nu is 2 times the metric that we have. So with this kind of a formalism laid down, we see that we initially have such a transformation under Lorentz transformation. This is the representation, but now this representation can be written as an exponentiation of the generators. So here, this is what we have. So we have seen that under Lorentz transformation, a field of a particular vector, the Dirac spinor, it transforms in such a particular fashion such that these matrices are, they are fixed for a particular representation, and these are the real parameters. There are six real parameters. These are antisymmetric indices. Three will be boost and three rotation. And this is how a spinor field transforms under Lorentz transformation. So this quite makes, we can remember this with the Klein-Gordon field. We saw that phi of x under Lorentz transformation transformed in this particular fashion. This is how a scalar field transformed with identity or 1 multiplied in the front. And this is how a Lorentz, this is how a spinor field is transforming, as we are seeing now. So one thing is important, that is this object that is here, this is not a wave function. There is nothing quantum mechanical till now here. Apart from the fact that like we can make an analogy with the wave function, but till now we have not used any notion of wave functions. This is completely a group theoretical viewpoint. And with this, we try to look at some properties of this spinor representation.